Time now for our Talk With segment, and we will be speaking to CZ, the founder and chief executive and owner of Binance, the world's biggest exchange for crypto assets, with trading volumes well above its competitors. CZ is also a world-leading figure in the crypto assets industry, and I'm joined on set by Alexis Laporte, Chief Innovation Officer at ODDO BHF, who will be asking CZ some questions in our Analyst Expert segment in a few minutes from now. CZ, thank you very much for joining us. It's been a big year for crypto assets. Bitcoin and the crypto market broke its all-time high for a $3 trillion market cap. 2021 also marked the beginning of institutional adoption, making crypto assets legitimate as a financial investment. Binance is clearly the world leader as a crypto exchange and seems to be going beyond its original business. Could you tell us what Binance is today?
Sure, thanks for having me. I think today Binance is bigger than a cryptocurrency exchange, as you said. We have an exchange business, which is a main business. We also own one of the most decentralized trust wallets called Trust Wallet. It's a mobile crypto wallet where you hold your own funds and own private keys. We have CoinMarketCap, which is the most visited website in the crypto space. We have our own NFT platform. We have we contribute to one of the most active blockchains in the space, Binance Smart Chain. There's a lot more. There's Binance Pay, Binance Marketplace, Binance Mini Program. But today we call ourselves an ecosystem in the crypto space.
And you recently made a public commitment to invest 100 million euros in France's crypto asset sector. How do you see the development of Binance in Europe and globally?
Sure. I think Europe is a very key market, and France has been the leader in this space in terms of crypto regulation maturity. So that 100 million euros is committed to France alone. And I think there's really four places where we will use it. We will use it to establish an R&D center with offices, et cetera. And we have already secured an office space, and it's in the process of renovations. So we'll have teams there, and then they'll be focused on blockchain research. So that's the sort of R&D center. The second place is really the investments. We have a Binance investment arm, which will also invest in blockchain and startups and businesses in the France ecosystem. So that's the investments angle. The third is we will do quite a bit on the education front. I think education is really important in this new industry. So we will allocate a portion of the funds. All of our educational efforts are free to the users, which means they will cost us some funds. So we think that's really important. Fourth thing is charity and donations. We already donated 2 million euros to restore one of the rooms in Chateau de Vassal, which is a beautiful chateau. And so we'll continue to do more and more of that.
Adoption has grown dramatically over the past few years. We now have 200 million crypto asset users worldwide. What do you consider has driven this growth?
So to be honest, most of the use cases in crypto that really driven growth are use cases that does not exist in traditional financial systems. Whereas payments, one of the most earliest obvious use cases, have not really taken off in crypto. People don't really use crypto to buy coffee, to be honest. But whereas, for example, blockchain fundraising globally, if you're an entrepreneur, you can use a blockchain to raise money for your projects globally very easily and very quickly. And that's a very powerful tool for entrepreneurs. NFTs is another method where artists and content creators can now monetize their work using their audiences globally. Again, you cannot do that with traditional fiat currency mechanisms or even through galleries, et cetera. There are some international bidding, et cetera, of auctions, but it just doesn't quite work the same way as NFTs. And DeFi is another example, GameFi and global cross-border remittances. All of those things are what current fiat currencies don't really do well. So we see all of those things taking off in the past year or a couple of years. So I think that's what the main driver is.
We have companies including Tesla, Square, PayPal. Global private firms and institutions have made their first move into the crypto space. What, in your opinion, is preventing everyone else from jumping on board?
To be honest, I think it's just a mindset issue. I think it's just things do take time to settle in. And given we are a $8 billion people population, it just takes time for the concept to go through the populations. People, some people, like 5 to 10% of the people in any population are early adopters. And I think we're at somewhere around 3 to 5% adoption based on 200 million people, or I would estimate it'll be higher, 400 to 500 million people who have some exposure to crypto. So, today we're just early adopter phase. And then as more and more people learn about it and more companies will come in. So I think it's just a matter of time.
It's a matter of time. We'll see how it pans out. I'm going to hand over to Alexis for our analyst expert segment.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, CZ, for being with us today. My first question is going to be about regulation. Central banks, regulator, governments have been looking to crypto assets for the past few years now. Do you see this as a necessary step for the market going forward?
Oh, absolutely. I don't think we can live in a world without any rules. I think regulation is still very necessary for the healthy growth of any industry, including the crypto industry, including traditional financial industries. And I think we will see more integrations of crypto blockchain industries with traditional financial industries. I think traditional financial industries will embrace crypto and vice versa. So we want to act as the bridge in between those two industries. And we think that regulations are super important for the healthy growth of the industry.
Thank you very much. And it's a perfect bridge between my next question, which is about CBDC's asset tokenization and tokenization in general. How do you see in the coming years really this bridge between traditional finance and decentralized finance happening?
Sure. I think there will be many different experiments. I think traditional finance, they will start to offer. We see many traditional banks already offering services to buy Bitcoin or buy other cryptocurrencies. But they're at the early stage of just buying Bitcoin, whereas crypto exchanges in the crypto space have been doing that since 2011, 2013-ish. We don't see the traditional services getting into NFTs, DeFi yet. I think that will happen. At the same time, we're seeing that crypto exchanges now having been able to better integrate with traditional payment services, SEPA channels, et cetera, which really facilitates the commingling of the two industries, which I think is really important for the growth of both industries. So we're seeing that happening. CBDCs, central bank digital currencies, is a really good innovation as well. And there's 200 different central banks around the world, roughly, and different central bank currencies probably will have different properties to some extent. We'll see which ones become more popular or become more easily adopted by users. And we believe the ones that are adopted quickly will eventually attract more other people to copy them. So yeah, so it's still early days. We'll see how that goes.
Thank you very much. And now it's a very hot question in the crypto Twitter sphere right now. It's about Web3. Blockchain is at the center of debates over Web3. So what is your take on this?
I think Web3 is, to be honest, no one really have everybody's definition of the word Web3 is somewhat different. My personal definition is more decentralized web and more rights to users, decentralized finance, where people control their finances and not subjected to other people's impact on their financial situations, and more use cases, et cetera. So I view Web3 as a really truly decentralized world where users have their voice and have their rights well protected. How we achieve that, what is Web3 or not, is open to a lot of debate. And I think that's not that important. What's important is we want to build products people want to use and give them more freedom to control their own destiny.
Thank you very much. For my next question, I think I will cut it in half, and maybe for population, could you yourself give a definition of what is an NFT?
Okay, NFT, technically speaking, is a blockchain token or asset that only have one of it, and you can clearly identify that without any ambiguity using the blockchain technology, which basically is 100% sure. Yeah, so that's what the technology is. So you can use that technology to represent a piece of art or other properties, and you can transact with it. And it offers, and because it lives on the blockchain, it can be verified, authenticity can be verified by the blockchain, which you can basically trust 100%. It's much easier to transact with confidence, much easier to transfer, and much easier for you to amass value.
Amazing. And so, you know, the second part of the question is about the metaverse. It's a huge topic right now. Even Facebook changed its name to Meta. So why do you think, or what is your vision about this metaverse?
Again, I think what exactly is metaverse is still yet to be defined. I think we're at the very beginning stages of this concept. Most people think of metaverse, they think about virtual realities where you put on a VR headset, you're in a 3D world, you can interact with people. Other people say, look, we already live in a metaverse today, using cryptocurrencies to pay for things, et cetera. I think the reality is probably going to fall somewhere in between. And today, we have not seen one mass application that's really taking off with, say, for example, hundreds of millions of users or even billions of users in one ecosystem. It's like, well, Facebook kind of defined the term social media to some extent. But right now, for this metaverse, even though they changed the name to Meta, they have yet to define what metaverse is. So I think in the next few years, we will see applications that will have hundreds of millions of users or even billions of users. And whatever those applications shape up to be, I think will be called the metaverse. But I do believe it is a highly interactive virtual 3D, even multiple dimensions potentially, and will have really positive impact for, will have a high demand for cryptocurrencies for transactions in that space.
And do you think the metaverse should be decentralized?
Yes, absolutely. I think metaverse, I believe by default, metaverse will be decentralized. There may be one application with one central server that everybody really likes to use. That's possible. But I think today we're already seeing many different types of metaverses, many different types of worlds people are building. And I think and many of those are built on top of blockchain technology. So they don't require a pure central server, and people transact directly on a one-to-one basis. So I think the world is getting more decentralized.
Thank you very much.
Time now for us to take some questions from the audience. Sure. CZ, we have an audience question for you. Are you considering to list a Binance like Coinbase did?
It's never out of the question. I think for right now, only US has a pathway, well, only Coinbase listed in the US as a cryptocurrency exchange. It has not happened in any other countries. There is a Binance US entity, which we do plan to follow the Coinbase route to the IPO in the US. Whereas other countries, it's not clear that anybody could just yet. So we would like to see more of that happening in other places. But you know, the future is always uncertain. We don't rule out any possibilities.
For many investors, cryptocurrencies, crypto assets are still UFOs, if you will. What's your advice to an investor who wants to understand if this new asset class of asset is actually worth it?
I mean, by UFOs, you mean unidentified financial objects or something, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so so crypto is many things. Many people try, when something new happens, a human's natural tendency is try to use something we're already familiar with and try to classify that as something like that. So for example, in the ocean, if you see an animal, you'll call it a fish. But when that animal starts to fly in the air, you call it a bird, or like, you know, you're kind of confused. Crypto is this new asset type. Well, I wouldn't even call it an asset type, even because asset types, people think about, you know, equities, currency, commodities. Cryptocurrency is a new technology. It's like, you know, internet is not a new type of internet is not a new type of radio or not a new type of TV. Internet has internet radio, internet TV, because it's a new technology that carries all of those mediums and more, and social media, etc. I think blockchain, cryptocurrencies, is a new technology that can support many new different asset types. You can have crypto securities, crypto commodities, cryptocurrencies, and many more that traditional financial systems doesn't have. So I think don't limit yourself to think crypto has to be one thing that you're familiar with. It's a new technology that allows endless possibilities.
Now, if people do invest in crypto assets, what do you recommend beyond trading on the Binance marketplace?
The number one thing I would recommend people who are new to crypto is start very small. Use less than 1% of your net worth, or even smaller, depending on how rich you are. But do not put a large amount of money into crypto right away. I do invest in crypto, and the way to learn about it is hold a little bit of it, transact with it, use it. Without doing that, you won't learning about it. Don't invest very large amounts. There are security considerations that you have. There's security steps or procedures you have to perform to hold your crypto securely, either on exchange or in your own wallet. So start small, learn about it, and then slowly increase your investment side if you like it. Not everybody have to like crypto. There are many different investment opportunities in the world. So that would be my number one advice. Number two advice is learn on your own. Learn deeply about maybe only less than five projects and learn them deeply. And don't just follow herd. Don't just, you know, whoever your friend says invest in this, invest in that without understanding what that is. It's a very dynamic field. Things change very quickly. Projects go up and down. The volatility is very high. So you do need to manage your risks. And the best way to manage your risks is to understand what you're investing in.
CZ, I have a question from Alexis who's going to jump in.
Yes, of course, because, you know, we're talking about, digital assets and, you know, for, you know, the way for investors to maybe enter this space. And I think a perfect example is, you know, the BNB asset that you have in Binance. Could you describe us, like, what the BNB is and what it does in your ecosystem?
Sure. BNB started as an exchange token, but now it's a really decentralized ecosystem. So this is the thing about cryptocurrencies. One coin can have many different use cases. At the beginning, BNB has if you hold it and use it to trade on Binance.com, then you get a discount on trading fees. So that's one advantage people have. And later on, there was Binance Smart Chain, which carries 12 million transactions per day. People use DeFi, they buy NFTs, they do staking, they do yield farming, and then they do cross-border transactions. And that happens on a decentralized blockchain that also uses BNB as gas. So if you want to use BSC, you have to have some BNB. There are many other use cases. You can use BNB to buy coffee, to buy airplane tickets, to pay for hotels through our partners. So there's many different use cases. And there's probably like 200 or 300 use cases at least that I can list. I won't be able to go through them, all of them one by one. But it's one of those tokens that's evolved over time, and now it's got a life on its own. Today, I think the Binance.com contributions to BNB value is actually quite small. I think most of BNB's value derives from other use cases that the community have built.
And another question, I think, for our audience is very important to understand that. We talk a lot about decentralized finance. How would you describe in very simple word what is DeFi and where it's going forward?
Sure. Again, there's many different definitions by different people for DeFi, but my definition is, or my understanding is very simple. Anything that, any financial services you can provide using the blockchain technology can be considered a DeFi. So today when we talk about DeFi, well, DeFi in the early days is really lending and borrowing. So you can what we call stake. You can, you know, lock in some one asset and take out a different asset, and that's kind of borrowing. That evolved to be a more advanced. Right now, when the people in the crypto industry talk about DeFi, they're talking about automated market makers, which is a little bit harder to understand. But basically, the money you lock and to lend, that money is used to build liquidity on an order book that other people who just want to trade can trade against. And the trading fees and the spread that's generated by trading, that earned from trading, is given as interest to the people who loan the money. And this model works because the more people who lend money into staking, the better liquidity it is on the order book. And when you have very good liquidity, when the traders want to trade against that, for example, if you just want to buy $5,000 worth of you know, BNB, when the liquidity is good, the slippage is very small. It's much cheaper for users to buy on the order books when the liquidity is very high. So users are willing to pay for a little bit of fee to get that better liquidity. They actually save money. And then the fee they pay used to pay for interest for the lenders, and that makes a closed system where the money the risks are fairly transparent to the loaners, and it's a business model that works to the point where the interest rates are typically high single digit or even double digits annually, and so and this is on top of Bitcoin or BNB or other cryptocurrency loans. So people use this for yield interest earnings, what we call yield farming. That's what DeFi is. So basically, there's a group of guys lending money for liquidity, and there's a group of guys who are paying to trade against that liquidity, and those fees goes back to the lenders, and that whole system works.
Fascinating. Maybe one last question on my side, and you know, of course, a lot of this is happening, you know, in the blockchain ecosystem. What about scalability? Because, you know, a lot of people are saying, okay, you know, the fees are getting crazy. You know, it's not scalable. You cannot do so many transactions per second. What is your view on the future of the evolution of blockchain technology itself?
So I very much agree with scalability is one of the most important things that we need to improve as an industry. I think using the internet analogy, we're probably at the modem days, and not a very fast modem at that. We're probably at 2400 baud for the people who are old enough to remember that. So it's like a dial-up modem using telephone lines, and it's really, really slow. So, but that's new. That's common for any new industry. When the internet was first started, it was very slow. Even today, using video conferencing, sometimes we still have some hiccups. So I think we're at the very early days of the blockchain industry. So for this industry to continue to grow, the capacity and the performance of the blockchains need to improve. And we're seeing that happening. We're seeing that blockchain capacity increasing at, you know, twofold, fivefold, tenfold each year.
CZ, I'm going to jump in with questions from our audience. One question, where would you consider to have your headquarters in the future?
I think everywhere. So I think we want to have an office in every country. We want to get a license in every country and operate out of every country.
But where would you want to be headquartered? You're not really answering the question.
We are considering a few leading jurisdictions for the global headquarters, but right now there's still a lot to see, right? So right now most of the regulations in the crypto space only focus on centralized exchanges, and in the centralized exchanges they primarily focus on KYC AML, which is very important. But there are many other aspects like your listing frameworks, how do you handle customer disputes, how do you do marketing, what type of marketing is encouraged, is not. And when we look beyond the centralized exchange space, you know, there's DeFi, there's the NFTs, there's fan tokens, there's GameFi, there's Metaverse. What are the regulations in those industries? So all of those things may impact where we station our headquarters. Our headquarters for the centralized exchange business may be in one country, and and our headquarters for the NFT business may be in a different country. So we'll have to see. But we have registered corporate headquarters already, and we're communicating that with regulators all around the world. We'll make that public when the time comes.
Okay. And final question: do you see a risk in stablecoins?
I think there's risk in everything. There's risk in, you know, fiat currencies. There's risk in real estate. So you got to understand that nothing in this world has zero risk. People should not take that bipolar kind of view. If you take that black and white binary kind of view, then you will miss a lot of nuances, and you will misjudge the risks. I think Bitcoin has risks. US dollars have risks. And stablecoins certainly have risks. They each have different type of risks. Stablecoins, whether they are backed by the currency that they claim to be backed, is one risk. They are algorithmic stablecoins, which are backed by either different cryptocurrency tokens. The volatility risk is there. So there are other risks with Bitcoin, other coins, etc. So we gotta take a measured view that everything has risks.
Alex, CZ, thank you very much for taking the time and speaking with us. Alexis, thank you very much, for your questions. That wraps up this segment of Talk With. Coming up next, the closing bell.